Do you know where the Garden of Eden is? I don't know where the Garden of Eden is. I know where there's a place in Tel Dan that's called Gan Eden. But the Garden of Eden is a place that there's been a lot of debate about where it possibly could be located. There's a lot of different theories, but nobody knows where it is, obviously, because it says that when Adam and Eve were driven out of the garden, there was an angel placed in front of the entrance to the garden with a flaming sword that would turn in every direction to block anyone from being able to gain access. And I believe that at some point in the future, when Yeshua regains total control of the earth, that Gan Eden will be open again to human, or the, I say humans. At that time, I believe we'll have our glorified forms. And because we're told that the tree of life will be available to us again, and that it will be bearing fruit, and that we will be able to eat that fruit. And so the tree of life, obviously, was in the garden, and that's what has been sealed from man to keep mankind from eating of that fruit and living in an eternally sinful state. So, anybody else want to say anything about that? The secondary question was, do you think the government knows where the Garden of Eden is? No. Why or what was the reasoning of splitting Yosef's tribe into the two tribes of Ephraim and Manasseh? Sometimes they're referred to both ways. Was it because the tribe of Levi became Yahweh's?
Well, the fact that Jacob chose to bless Joseph and include Jacob made that decision. It's like if you had 12 kids and on your deathbed you make a decision that one of them is going to be disinherited and another one is going to get a double portion. That decision was made by Jacob, and it was just a technical record in the scripture about recording, because since Jacob made the decision that there would be a double portion given to Joseph, that he only had two sons, and by those two sons, or at least those are the two sons that Jacob blessed, then you would have the tribe of Manasseh and you'd have the tribe of Ephraim. Is that... Is the question
so
one of
the gone from the 12 tribes to the 13 tribes?
You lost Levi when it comes to dividing the land. Okay, Levi is absorbed into, he's different. But also by the end of the scripture, I believe, and this is one of the mysteries we don't understand, when it gets to the book of Revelation, Dan's not in there, right? The tribe of Dan is not listed in Revelation. So we don't know on that. We don't know the reasoning. So, I mean, it depends on whoever asked the question. Are you talking from God's perspective or just from the historic perspective of why are there two? The historic perspective was the patriarch made that decision. Now, from God's, why did God have the patriarch make that decision? That would be an interesting topic to discuss.
If my memory serves me right, there are three different locations where it lists the tribes in the scripture. In all three of those locations, the listing is different. So,
and yet we know that the New Jerusalem will have 12 foundations and there are 12 apostles. So the number 12 is significant, yet there's these interesting little...
So there's
thing that we don't know. We don't know why God chose that.
Anybody else have any ideas? That one? Yeah?
Well, I know that, I mean, if I'm remembering correctly, didn't God speak his decision about setting apart the tribe of Levi a time after Jacob had made the decision to give the double portion to Joseph? I mean, it was not close to that.
Moses did that.
It was on down the road. So I guess for a time, maybe there were 13, maybe.
So what happened to the tribe of Dan in Revelation?
We don't know. We don't know why that was not included.
And we know also Jacob, Joseph was Jacob's favorite. Joseph was given the coat of many colors, which we recently learned was an indication of the firstborn, was the indication of the
authority.
So Reuben would have been birth order for the one that would get the double portion, the firstborn. But Jacob chose that it went to Joseph.
Rachel's firstborn, who was his favorite.
But Reuben fell out of favor when he slept along his father's concubine or his wife. It's kind of like it was a curse to him because he had done it. Even in the blessings, when we talked about it in pronunciation, he said, you will. You've lost out, basically.
Right. The pronouncement upon Reuben was not really a blessing. Okay. Were some of the first believers called Nazarenes? And then the secondary question, what has happened to the, it says Nazarites, but then it has under parentheses Nazarenes. Answer to the first question is yes, that was one of the terms that was used for the, there were actually several names that were given to the followers of Yeshua. They were known as the Way. They were, of course, it wouldn't be Nazarene in Hebrew. It would be Nosri, which actually means branch. Okay. So Nosrim would be branches. They were known as Nosrim. It tells us that they were eventually referred to as, and it's translated, Christians in Antioch. And I don't remember what that Greek word is.
Ecclesia.
No. Not in that particular place. The word ecclesia means assembly or congregation. What has happened to the... a Nazarite is a person who specifically has taken a Nazarite vow. Okay, that's different than a Nazarene. Nazarene had to do with people that lived in the region of Nazareth, the city. Okay, and the reason that they were called Nozrim, it's kind of a play on words. Okay, Nozrim means branches, but it also referred to that region around Nazareth, and that was where Yeshua and the disciples, that region was where they were from. What has happened to the Nazarites? Nazarites, there are still people that take Nazarite vows today. And if you want to read specifically about what all is involved in a Nazarite vow, it's in the scripture. And you can do a study on that. Now, what has happened to the Nazarenes? That's a different question. That basically, what you're asking is, what happened to the original Messianic Jews?
And that's a history lesson.
And that's a history lesson, which I have time to give you.
You do?
Yes. In fact, that's the subject of one of these things that I brought with me today in case we... You guys have done a very good job of providing questions, so... And I'm not going to read this. I'm going to use it as a to keep me on track. In order for us to get a proper understanding of what actually transpired, you have to go outside of the Bible. Okay. There are extra biblical historical writings. Some of the sources would be the works of Flavius Josephus, the Apocrypha, the Talmudim, the Midrashim, and the writings of the early church fathers. These writings, and it's a lot of reading, will give you an idea of the historical progression that took place from the time that Yeshua ascended through, I believe, the early church fathers actually extends through the 7th century. Okay? And what we find out from these extra-biblical writings was that there were three major Jewish revolts that happened around the time of Yeshua, or just after Yeshua ascended. The first one everybody, especially in this congregation, knows about, and that was what was called the Great Jewish Revolt, which ended in 70 CE with the with them sacking Jerusalem and destroying the Second Temple, the Romans. But that was, there were two other revolts that occurred after that one, the final one being what was called the Bar Kokhba Revolt. And that one ended, it began, that revolt began in 132 CE and ended in 135 CE with Rome coming in and killing thousands and thousands of Jewish people. And then taking the rest, the remaining Jews, and further dispersing them to minimize the threat of any further revolts against the empire. All right. The history that is involved in that whole thing. Let's begin at the beginning with Yeshua coming on the scene, having Talmudim, people following him, people being taught by him. In the milieu, the cultural soup, if you want to call it that, of that time, Yeshua was just one of many rabbinic teachers who were teaching their own ideas of how to follow the Torah. Now, obviously, we would not reduce him down to just merely being another one of the rabbis, but as far as the Jewish community was concerned, he was radical. And they didn't like what he was saying, but in their estimation, he was another rabbi with another school, okay? But as time went on, they began to obviously realize that he was more than just that. As far as the rabbinic community was concerned, he was a threat to them. And, but... when he died, as far as they were concerned, that was pretty much over with, except for the fact that the followers, the number of followers kept growing. And so this sect of Judaism, known as the Way, grew until there were multiple hundred thousand Jewish persons that believed in Yeshua as the Messiah. It was a very, very large community initially. And then you have this situation that we just discussed earlier where the Gentiles begin coming. And so now you're adding even more people to the number of Messianic believers. But as the Jewish people continue to try to throw off Roman oppression, and you had these subsequent revolts, with every time the Jewish people tried to throw off the Roman Empire, then the Roman Empire would come down on them even harder, with more killings and more persecution and so on and so forth. And the Gentile people that had come to faith in Yeshua and were hanging with the Messianic Jews, they began to say, now wait a minute, we're Gentiles. This isn't our fight. We're not interested in throwing off Roman rule. And so we don't want to end up getting persecuted just because we're associating with these Jewish people. Because Rome was not making a distinction. He didn't care, Rome didn't care whether you were Messianic or non-Messianic. And if you were associating with the Jews, you were, as far as they were concerned, you're just as guilty as the Jews, whether you actually had been involved in anything or not. Okay? So the Gentiles began a process of pulling back from the Jews. Okay? In this mix, you have a very famous and very well-respected rabbi named Akiva, who to this day is respected in the Jewish community. Rabbi Akiva became convinced that this person named Shimon Bar Kokhba was the Messiah who would lead the Jewish people to finally rid them of Roman tyranny. He was personally so convinced of this, he went to the Sanhedrin and was able to convince the current Sanhedrin of that day to agree with him that Bar Kokhba was the Messiah, to agree with him that they needed to rise up yet again and try to throw off Rome. And so, I don't know whether it was Rabbi Akiva or representatives of his organization or whatever, approached the Messianic community and asked them, will you join us in declaring Bar Kokhba the Messiah and join us in this fight against Rome to finally rid us of Roman tyranny? And we all know the Messianics could not, they couldn't agree to do that. Yeshua was the Messiah. They clearly knew that and believed that. They could not proclaim anybody else Messiah. And secondarily, because of what Yeshua had taught them, resisting Rome in that manner was not an option for them. Spiritual battle against the forces of darkness, yes. But rising up in revolt against the Roman Empire, they would not do that. And so they said no. Well, that infuriated, obviously, the non-Messianic Jewish community. But they were determined. They actually believed, even though they were greatly outnumbered, they actually believed that God would give them victory like He had given the Maccabees victory, and that they would eventually overthrow the Roman Empire. And so they pursued this revolt, the Bar Kokhba revolt. And of course, I already told you the outcome. Rome came in and finally squashed any possibility of the Jews ever revolting against the Roman Empire again. When that happened, the non-Messianic community blamed the Messianic community and said it was because you would not join us that we lost. You betrayed your people to death. Because, like I said, there were thousands and thousands of Jewish people that were killed when Rome came to squash this revolt. And so, with the increasing persecution against the Jewish people, the Gentile community, before the revolt actually happened, the Gentile community completely cut off relations with the Jewish community. So now you have the Gentile believers heading off by themselves, completely disconnected from their Jewish brethren, and they started heading down their own road, their own interpretation, their own understandings, their own ways of looking at things, their own development of theology. And then on the other side, you've got the rabbinic, non-Messianic Jews who now have rejected the Messianic Jews and said, we don't want to have anything to do with you because you're traitors. So that left the Messianic community isolated by themselves. And history tells us that by the 4th century CE, there were very, very few Messianic Jews left. And eventually, they pretty much died out as any kind of influencing force in the world. Now, we also know historically that through all of these thousands of years, there has been a tiny remnant of Jewish people that have believed in Yeshua all of this time. And so when we look at what has happened in the 1960s with the rebirth of the Messianic Jewish movement, we know it's miraculous. We know it was a God thing. We know that it's a timing issue. And that is one of the clearest evidences of us living in the last days is the reemergence of the Messianic Jewish movement.